This last piece we're going to work with here with the categorical data is a test of independence. So let's just jump into the example. The data for this sample is from the Haynes Health and Nutrition Examination Survey of 1976 to 1980, in which the Public Health Service examined a representative cross-section of 20,322 Americans ages 1 to 74. The goal was to obtain some type of baseline data regarding the demographic variables such as age, education, income, psychology variables such as, physiology variables such as weight, cholesterol levels, and the prevalence of diseases. Now, from the sample 20,000, it took a subset of 2,237 Americans, specifically in the 25 to 34 age group. One of the variables recorded in that subsample was handedness, as in right-handed or left-handed, or ambidextrous. The table below represents the data collected. Is there evidence to suggest there's a difference in handedness based on gender? See, now I have two variables here. The goodness of fit, I would have had one variable, perhaps just handedness with different levels. Now I have two variables. I have handedness and I have gender. So this creates this table, sort of, it is a table. And then these percentages were calculated more, just so you can take a look at. You can see that 1.8% of the men were ambidextrous, 10%-ish was left-handed, and a little over 87% was right-handed. 91% of the women were right-handed, 7 left, and 0.68% were ambidextrous. So looking at these percentages, it looks like there may be a difference in handedness between gender. It certainly, gut feeling is that there might be, because there's definitely some differences here. Whether the differences are big enough to pick up on, that's another story. So that's a big difference between the test of independence and goodness of fit test. Goodness of fit has one variable, multiple levels. The test of independence has two variables with multiple levels. If this only had, let's pretend the ambidextrous didn't exist, then we could do two sample proportions or an odds ratio. But with this third one here, that's what kind of messes up the idea of odds ratios and proportions. Hence, the test of independence is pretty important. Now, the null hypothesis here, generically, would be that the rows and columns are independent. So the columns and the rows are independent. So here, this is going to be gender. That's the columns. And handedness. Are independent. The alternative is that there's a connection between these. In other words, they are dependent. And let's just state the 0.05 alpha like usual. Now, we want to address the assumptions. And the exact same assumptions that we dealt with before just fits a multinomial experiment. And it is, because each individual is going to go into one category only. Well, I guess you could claim two categories, but the point is, in the men, it's going to be either men or the women. And then the handedness is going to be one of these. So it's not like somebody's going to be left-handed a man and right-handed a woman. That can't happen to the same person. And then when you go one by one through all the other necessary assumptions, they are satisfied. Now, what's kind of odd about this that you're not going to do immediately is the idea of the proportions. You could calculate all of these, but these are the observed proportions. These are like the PIs, not the PIs. So we're actually not going to be looking specifically at all those proportions here. That's kind of done internally in the calculations, because what happens is it makes the assumption of independence to begin with. Based on independence, if you go back to chapter 6, you can figure out how many people you expect to see in each of these categories based on the idea of independence in the table. So here, the assumptions I just kind of talked through briefly. Now let's go ahead and complete the analysis. And when we do in TC stats, just like in the goodness of fit, it's going to give us the expected values. And these are the calculated expected values. You're about to see them in TC stats. Now, the way I'm going to go about this in TC stats is actually two different ways. If we were to have all this data in one column, the gender, in another column indicating whether they're right or left-handed. TC Stats will automatically, by selecting the columns over here, would generate the table for you. But I don't have the data like that. This observed and probabilities is the data that I used for the goodness of fit. So what I'm going to do is create my own matrix. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to edit the values and I'm going to set the size. Now this had three rows and two columns. Remember, the rows was right, left, ambidextrous. The columns were male and female. Now I can easily switch this around. It doesn't really matter. So you can kind of do it the way you want. And then I'm going to put these values that I observed into this matrix. So in other words, I'm going to copy these values directly into the calculator or into TC Stats. So here I've typed them all in. Now, if I wanted to, I'm not going to mess with it here, but if I simply tap on the column one and erase this, remember that was the men, I can change all these headings. This was female. And I'm just going to abbreviate this as right. See, that one was left-handed. See, if I can't reach the next column here. Actually, I guess I can scroll, yeah. And this is ambidextrous. So I'm just going to do R, L, and A. So that's the matrix that we just saw earlier. So now I can go ahead and update. And this gives me my p-value, and the p-value here tells me I would reject. So the null hypothesis being that they're independent, the alternative being that they're dependent, this is saying that there is a difference. There is a dependence on gender and handedness. There's a connection between the two. Now, the degrees of freedom is 2. That's the number of rows, 3 minus 1, which is 2, multiplied by the number of columns, 2, minus 1, which is 1. So it's 2 times 1, which is 2. Just quickly, the degrees of freedom is the number of rows minus 1 multiplied by the number of columns minus 1. This was 3 minus 1 times 2 minus 1. So this is 2 times 1, which is 2. That's where those degrees of freedom are coming from. Now if I tap on expected values, that's my expected value matrix. And I need the same thing I needed before. I need them all to be at least 1. They are. No more than 20% to be less than 5. Well, the smallest is 13. So I'm good to go there. Again, for my students, you have to create this table. Now, to save time for my students, I would accept the table that said 955.97. Just get rid of all these because they didn't do any good. The smallest is 13, it's not a problem. This decimal doesn't make a difference. If you get close to that cutoff, that 1 or the 5, then I'll be putting in decimal values here. But otherwise, you can save a bunch of writing. I would just do 955, 1048, 97, and so forth. So that's pretty much it. That is the chi-square test of independence. We compared the columns with the rows. We said that they're independent. The alternative is that they are dependent based on the small p-value. We rejected the null and said that there's a connection between the two. There's a dependence between handedness and females, or handedness and gender based on this data.